That's a good question. I don't think I addressed it. So thank you. Thank you for asking that. You cannot put the sills in all at once, and we think there may need to be up to 50 sills. You can't put them in all at once because there would be downstream immediate impacts. They need to be put in gradually. We also think they could be put in during the wintertime when there isn't ice in the river like right now. And done gradually so that the impact downstream is minimized. But you could probably also, right now, because of the storms we have, Erie and Ontario water levels are rising. So when they're up near their long-term average, lowering the impact, the maximum impact on Lake Erie temporarily would be 5 centimeters. Not a dramatic impact when you consider what the benefits are. So I think we would start to see some impact within a few years, but the full impact might not be felt for 10 years. But if we don't stop that downward trend line, at least once we stabilize riverbed, that would stop the downward trend line, then we can gradually bring it back up. Does that help?
Losing water in our waterfronts and the dredging in the industry. But I'm also concerned, this is our drinking water we're talking about, fresh water that isn't recharging. So, I mean, we have that cycle that we all live on. We wash and we drink. It's very, very important that we do something about this as soon as possible, besides all the other reasons that you've mentioned. And I guess one of the things that I haven't heard, and I don't know whether the Sierra Club's even involved in looking at, is things like when they talk about fracking for gas, that actually withdraws a whole ton of water as well, and they're talking about doing that around the Great Lakes. Does the Sierra Club get involved with that?
Yes, we do. Right now, we have stopped diversions, further diversions of water. I don't know if York Region takes Ontario water up across the hydrological divide and then sends it south via sewage pipelines. There's been interest in extending that pipeline even further, and interest, for instance, in taking water out of Lake Simcoe and sending the sewage south to Lake Ontario. We oppose that very aggressively, and we've been asking for regulations. And finally, we're seeing some sign that the Ontario government is going to put in regulations to prohibit intrabasin transfers. We've also lobbied very hard to get fees on water taking for water bottling operations. That has hit huge opposition. There are fees now. We're suggesting that they be increased because often that water is shipped out of the Great Lakes Basin. As far as fracking goes, right now we don't have a proposal for Georgian Bay. But I've heard there's rumors. But yes, we will engage in that. And yes, the water takings for that would be absolutely enormous. And the impact, too. So we haven't engaged with that, but we will once we see a proposal. So I can tell you anything that affects the Great Lakes. And I didn't say this. The Great Lakes are mainly a finite resource. It's a glacial deposit left from the retreat of the Ice Age. And only about 1% of it is a renewable resource. But right now, we've got a 10% increase in the outflow of Lake Huron into the St. Clair River. That's 10 times the renewable resource. This is unacceptable.
20 years ago. And my suggestion at that time was we should drop the Mulberry Harbour, which I guess some gentlemen here, as old as I am, would know what that was, and that was the harbour that we built for D-Day. That was concrete ships that you could open the valves and lower them in. My problem with the system that you've got is how are you going to enter those sills?
Just by their weight alone, they weigh so much, but they will be attached. It will build foundations for them that they will be pinned down into, and those pins will stabilize their location.
But how are you going to lock them down?
They will, those pins, I can't remember the exact words that the engineers use for locking. You put the pin down and then it's locked in position.
I've been around this world a long time. I'm 93 years old.
Right.
And I don't see how you're going to do it because they are floating.
Pardon?
They're floating units.
No, they're not floating. You float them into position, then you open up the valve.
You lower them down.
When they fill up with water.
That's correct.
So they sink.
They're not sunk right down to the bottom.
So the ones where there's fish habitat will sit up on.
Sit on top. Is the water going to go down underneath that and wash it all out again?
No, the riverbed will have to be stabilized throughout the entire area.
With what here?
Pardon?
What are you going to stabilize it with?
With riprap rock.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, you know, I just don't see it. I commend what you're trying to do. But I've been around this area a long time. I've been in business here for 40 odd years. And I just don't see it. Because everybody has turned us down in the past of what we wanted to do. You're going through the same system now. Everybody's turning you down.
No, I don't think so. I mean, incredibly, the U.S. Army Corps, they had a two-hour conference call with us last weekend, went through the details of this. W.F. Baird Coastal Consulting Engineers are one of only a handful of companies throughout the world. They do work all over the world, building incredible shoreline structures. Yeah. I was just on a conference call with him yesterday, Rob Aaron, who's principal. They know that these will work. They know. They looked at the design. They actually came back to us and said, would you like us to give us a cost, cost estimate for this? And so we did that.
Well, I'd like to see a drawing that shows how you're going to stabilize those sills into the ground to stop them from washing down. Because the weight of them, the water inside is only the same weight as the water outside. So basically, they are a floating unit.
But huge weight concrete-wise. You realize how long they are, the length of this?
Well, I know that. That's why I suggested the region a little bit longer they are, which was the same sort of construction.
Yeah.
It was all turned down in those days. I'm talking about 20 odd years ago.
Yeah. You realize that this will all be done with high-tech, three-dimensional computer modeling, so they can simulate this before they even go out into the river. And we're also suggesting build a prototype and put it down in the riverbed, put a video camera down, watch what happens to it.
Yeah.
And then they can start to do this summer.
I realize the design that you've shown there is like a step design from
on
down
one
there.
Side.
And that's why it can't turn over. Otherwise, if it's just straight up and down, it would be washed right over. You've done a good job. Anyhow.
Thank you, sir.
I'll send more things.
Okay.
Water being taken off Georgian Bay, going into Honda, going into Tecumseh, going into Bradford. Is it a drop in the bucket? And I guess my other question is the water that comes off for Honda, I think it's 1 million gallons a day, which they're cleaning and putting most of it back. What's most of it and who's monitoring how clean it is? And overall, the watershed south of that, what
right.
impact it has on Georgian Bay.
Yeah, that's a good question. Honda has to return the water to the Nautilus Harbour River, so it does flow back into Georgian Bay. We were initially concerned because there was a fair amount of it being lost due to evaporation, and through our efforts, they were forced to put in cooling towers to capture the steam and cause condensation so they can capture it and return it into the Nautilus Harbour River. For the first time ever, Environment Canada has offered funding for research, and together with McMaster University, we put forward a proposal we're waiting to hear, and one of our projects is definitely looking at the Nautilus Harbour River, working with the Conservation Authority, doing a lot of water quality work there. We also want to figure out why the fish and birds are dying and washing up on the shores. But we were told we can't use the word water levels and we can't use the word botulism. But fortunately, we're working with scientists who don't care if they can't use those words in the proposal because they'll use them in their reports. So, yes, water quality is a concern, and for the first time, we're hoping to get some funding so we can start to take a serious look at this. So, thank you.
Hey. The average, and this is a conservative average, each one of those boat slips is about $12,000. That's what people spend. It's a rough estimate. Well, if you do some quick math in your head, and you take $12,000 times 440, and you eliminate that sounds like, How much money?
$500,000.
So right away, when somebody says, what's the negative impact? That's the starting point. That's not to mention all the other people who don't use a boat slip, who have a boat, they want to go and launch it and things like that. I've heard from people in the community saying, I moved to the community because I had access to the water. I don't have that access anymore. Which means you may see a for sale sign in front of their house. As far as municipalities are concerned, we had a long talk a couple of weeks ago with some of the mayors that are part of the coalition over by Owen Sound and Meaford. They're looking at the fact that they have to extend the outfall pipe or the intake for their water and sewage treatment plants. That's a lot of money to do. Unless there's some money from the federal and provincial government in an emergency situation to help those municipalities, everybody pays for it. That's why I said, they just don't get it. Mayor Marshall and I, we talked to the new Minister of Natural Resources. They don't get it, do they, Jerry? They don't get it.
Not yet.
Not yet. We're going to hope they get it. We're pushing it. So, does anybody want to come up? Tell us.
He regrets he's unable to attend this meeting. And he's tied up with his duties as Speaker of the House in Ottawa. And his chief of staff planned to attend, but had at the last minute a medical situation. Bruce asked me to take notes, and I'm going to report to him tomorrow morning. He commented that the seriousness of the low water levels has been discussed at high levels in Ottawa in great detail. Members of Parliament from this region are fully aware, and are following the issue with concern. The authority for action is really the International Joint Commission on the Great Lakes. He wants to thank you, Mayor Warnock, and Council for organizing this meeting, and thank you, Mary, for a very good presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. Anybody?
Township of Georgian Bay gave me a call, said that, how do you, as white contracting, see the economic impact on this? I said, well, back in about November, a little bit on the selfish side, I looked at it from a business perspective for what can we do from our business perspective, and also how can I go over there and earn some money? So I took my own little map of the Honey Harbour Hamlet. I went around. We've got approximately 27 commercial industries, including trailer parks, marinas, some stores, national park, and so forth. Approximately 17 of them are going to see a reduction in business due to the water levels, right off the hop. The national park and the federal government said, well, we can't do anything about it because we only own from the high water to the high water. We have to apply to our own ministries in order to do this. To do any short-term work in and around the water, and that's all any sort of dredging or waterworks or anything of that nature is, or dock extensions, it's all short-term, other than the type of stuff that you're looking at here. So almost all of them need to do something. The federal government has no intention of doing that yet. When you approach any of the ministries, depending on where in the water course that you are, you have anywhere from 4 to about 6 or 7 different ministries and agencies which you have to be in contact with, most of which do not correlate their information from one to another. So they're in some cases they're doing their best because they're almost, shouldn't say this, without breaking some federal laws in order to enable people to try and live and exist and coexist. So then when I was with the economic development officer, she said, what's the average out of your 17 people? I said, $80,000. She almost fell over. We've got a little bay where our business has been. We've been around since 1946. I think our business has been in this bay 40 odd years. There's two marinas plus us. It's a $300,000 endeavor for three family-owned businesses to maintain our businesses. And then when I was speaking with this with the lady from the township, she said, geez, that's those are great numbers, thank you very much. I said, oh, no, I'm good at this. I said, it's a lot more than what you're thinking. It's not just about me, it's not just about the boats, and it's not just about the Marines. She said, okay, where are you taking me? I said, now I'm taking you into the building code. Every building, and when you go into part 8 of your building code, has to have a sustainable sewage system. From, more so, let's say, from Victoria Harbour north, there's all kinds of island properties or water access only properties. If we aren't allowed to do something short term, until the long term, if we want to call it a solution, until the long term change takes place, if we don't do anything short term, the building code is going to have to step up and foreclose on many, many properties because people won't be able to properly maintain their sewage systems. So this absolutely did not occur to her. She said, oh my God, am I ever glad I phoned you. She said, how many numbers? I said, I couldn't guess. There's entire bays. 2 years ago, a gentleman approached us about, would you be interested in dredging our bay for us? I said, geez, you got what, 9 cottages in here? He said, no, there's 10. That one hasn't been used in 10 years. You can't see it. We can't get into that bay now. People are now switching boats. The property values are substantially declining. And when I was speaking with the development officer, I said, you know, if the different ministries involved don't allow, or if they deny these people access by any means to these properties, do these people have the right to go and sue you for denying them access? And if they ever get near there, the average cottage, most of us know, is 600,000 today. So if 100 of those people, don't worry about your 40, your half million that you're thinking, by the way, I think you're beyond conservative, I think you're way underestimating.
Well, I always err on the side of caution.
If it ever gets towards where the sewage stuff becomes a problem, and when you're trying to drive a point home, to me, when you talk with somebody's finances, they listen. When we deal with health and safety, people are obligated to listen. And I'm a bit of a poop disturber on my own right. And that sort of stuff really gets people's attention because nobody wants that stuff in the water, near the water, or what have you. And if you don't allow them access to maintain, who assumes the responsibility for those buildings?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now, and this is how the impact is to my particular business, which has an impact to this, and this, and this, and this. And it's like a stone in the water, and there it goes, and the ripple, and the ripple.
Yeah.
Can you do me a favor? I gave you that email address. Can you send that email address the information you just shared with us? Because that's the type of thing that's going to get noticed. You talk about the health and safety issues. You talk about the negative economic impact. And you're one business.
That's right.
How many businesses? I got guys in the back row sitting there, the marina operators and everything else. Pardon me, sir?
If you add it all up, it's probably around $200 million.
That's what we conservatively, when we were at this meeting with the PC caucus the other morning, the number we were throwing out was about $250-300 million.
Our building and planning department is bordering on Terrified. The lot lines in around Honey Harbor and most of the bayfront are non-parallel. Mother Nature didn't build parallel islands.
Yeah.
The lot lines are not parallel. They're going to allow docks of greater length to try and accommodate people, which is great. There's side lot setbacks. So is it first come, first serve? How's it going to happen? And inevitably, because we're humans, we're going to sue each other
right, for
something. So the amount of time and resources it's going to take within our township, instead of doing other things, let's say, they're going to be burdened with huge numbers of permit applications and so forth, and the amount of labor that it's going to take them, because they're going to have to investigate to a certain level so that they don't run into all these lawsuits. And inevitably, there will be some.
Yeah.
That's just the nature of it.
Anyway, thank you very much for sharing that with us tonight.